elected Pastor Paul Rajadurai and Binu brother Anil sir and others who have joined today. I would like to greet all of you in the name of Jesus Christ. It's a great privilege that we spend together a time like this before we do our VBS, so that we desire to have a better understanding concerning our children, and it will work as a motivating factor for us to minister to children, and that is what we desire for. We in Excel Ministry, when we reach out to hundreds and thousands of children, we understand that the ministry to children is one of the most significant ministries these days, and because it is in such a time that a generation is taken away from spirituality by the snares of the devil, and a generation doesn't value spirituality as it used to be by our old generation, and we are witnessing a huge transition in spirituality as it comes to the new generation. We call them millennials or Gen Z and things like that. So it is imperative that we understand our children in a much more practical way. And today's talk is designed in such a way as to help us to understand the importance of it. Now, let me share my screen with you, my PPT with you. And I also wish that you will be asking questions as we move forward. Anytime you feel like asking a question, you are free to type your question here. And I'll be glad to conduct our session as interactive. Or by the end of the session, I expect that some of you will have some questions to type and or unmute and ask me as well. So be ready for some interaction towards the end. And when we interact, I would like to interact with you as someone who has been involved into counseling for the last 15 years and someone who has studied children, especially adolescents. In my PhD research, I have studied 1,500 adolescents in terms of some of their behavior. So with that background in mind, we will be able to discuss better, I hope. So today's topic I have termed like this: God's mission to children today. God's mission to children today. There is a verse in the Bible, Deuteronomy 6, verses 6 and 7, if you have noted in the Bible. It goes like this: the statutes, the laws that the Lord has given to you, you the people of Israel, the laws, the regulations, the instructions that I have given you, you need to talk about the instructions of the Lord, the laws of the Lord, to your children. Yeah, to your children. If you have a Bible with you, you can turn to those verses and read. Okay, talk about the laws of God to children when you sit at home. I have underlined that, when you sit at home. And when you walk along, I have underlined that as well, walk along the road. When you lie down, I have underlined that, when you lie down. And when you get up, I have underlined even that, when you get up. See, look at what God is saying. The laws of God, the instructions of God that is given to the people of Israel, must be talked about to the children when they sit at home, number one, when they walk in the road, number two, when they lie down, number three, when they get up, number four. Now tell me, is there any other time the children are engaged into anything else? Look at that. Either they are sitting at home, or they are on the road going somewhere, or they are sleeping, lying down, or they are getting up. What does it mean? It simply means 24 hours a day. Right? Every time they are awake, you need to talk to them about the laws of God. Tell them the desires of God. Tell them the do's and don'ts. Not little too much, that the Lord is asking for? Of course, the Lord is asking for an extreme level of spiritual instruction to children. Don't you think so? Why is he doing that? Now, can you imagine the time your children get up, you teach them the word of God, okay? They're sitting at home. Every time you see them, you're teaching them the word of God. You're going for a supermarket, I mean, some shopping. You're talking to them about word of God. Oh, they come home. They're about to lay down to sleep. You're talking to them about word of God. Can you imagine that today? Whether you do it or not, let me tell you this. The devil is so cunning and the devil is so active. The devil is teaching them values of evil. The devil is planting into them the seeds of poison, of sin. The devil is sowing the seeds. When? Yeah, when your children are browsing through internet, when they sit at home, right? What do they do? Yeah, do you know that 64% of your children below 15 years of age have watched pornography? Yeah, we don't take that kind of data for us to get alarmed. Since we don't know, we don't need to get alarmed. But then let me tell you, some of the surveys recently, it says 45% of the children use internet for some other purpose while they attend online class. Yeah, online class will go on. They will minimize that and they will play games or chat in the social media, see Instagram status, everything. 45% of the children. Oh, it's a huge number. 64% of the children, that's what I'm saying. It is alarming us. They are addicted. Most of them are addicted. At least 27% of them are addicted. I'm talking about children below 15 years. Okay, when they sit at home, what do they do? We have no clue because we are not there at home. Husband goes for job, wife go for job. I mean, we need to because this is a survival need. We need to. And where are the children? Because physically their schools and colleges are not open. They are at home. And what do they do? Oh, that's a huge question. So the devil is so active, very, very active. And when they see the status in Instagram, recently I have come across this when I was talking to some youngsters. Some of the youngsters who come to me for counseling are people who are struggling with life, of course. This is what some of them said. They said, old times when others are not active in Instagram, these kinds of people get into Instagram, like let's say 2 o'clock in the night to 4 o'clock early morning. It's at that time they search for people, like similar-minded people, that's what they say. And they also tell me, sir, Insta is full of fake identity. When I get into Insta, I never reveal my identity. I write some other name, like Good for Nothing is one name. And then people who feel that they are also not good for nothing, they are good for nothing, easily are attracted to me. Life is meaningless. End of life. All those kinds of attitude, all those kinds of expressions, people with similar kind of expressions get along. Then what do they discuss? They discuss about suicide. They post this and that that connects people to get into all kinds of self-destructive behaviors. And they cut their hand here and there and they take the picture and upload the blood. And others who follow them are motivated to do the same. And parents, where are they? Parents think, oh, my children, they are sleeping very well in the night, and my children are so spiritual. And the moment somebody talk about anything like that, they said, no, not my children. Yeah, there may be children, but my children are not like that. Of course, good. Your confidence is very good. But it is always good that we understand what is going on among the children, especially among our children. Because the devil should not cheat them. At the end, we should not be in a position where we get alarmed and that ultimately we say, oh my goodness, why I did not know that my children are into this and that. What on earth made me to be so ignorant about what is going on among my children? I never knew this. I never ever knew this. Even 3 days ago, one of the children of a very famous person, that person is known by many, many others. So he called me and said, at least in Zoom conference call, please talk to my boy, and he is showing this and that, and I'm not able to understand why he is behaving like this and like that. And I was into a conversation. I realized that he is already into the clutches of devil. Children who are given all the context to grow spiritually. And that is a family where he told me every day we sit for at least 30 to 40 minutes in family prayer. But my child is into occult again. Why on earth is it happening? Why is it that he has been doing it for the last 4 years and I never knew it? He couldn't accept that. He was even crying. So what I'm saying is, look at what Word of God is admonishing us. It's a huge understanding if you take it in its real sense. 24/7, the devil is very, very active. When your children are sitting at home, what do? Most of the time they watch a cartoon, right? Of course, we can't prevent children from watching cartoon. One of the things that they spend their time. Otherwise, sir, you tell me, what can they do when sitting at home? Can they read Bible all the time? No, of course they cannot. So they should have some vent to entertainments. What is the entertainment? I just would like you to think about it from a different angle. That's all. I'm not blaming all the children for that. I'm just saying, it's good that we look at it from this angle also. Now, look at these cartoons that promotes violence. Hitman, Superman, Iron Man, that man, Batman, this man, that man, all this man. What is that happening there? It's all violence, right? Violence. Yeah. Now, just for the sake of understanding it in a simple, literal sense, do one thing. In a room, you switch on a television, and in that television, you switch on the wrestling channel, okay? WWW wrestling, something like that. That channel, yeah, wrestling champion, John Cena, Roman Reigns, and the black, yeah, Klesner, this and that. So Undertaker and kind of people. Those are the heroes of our children. Okay, so you switch on that channel. Let there be 4 or 5 young children sitting. Young children in the sense, maybe 10 years, 8 years, 7 years, like that. And you close the door and go. Come after 20 minutes. Open the door. What will you see? Yeah, wrestling championship in the TV. But wrestling championship literally, because they will be fighting with each other. You test it. Because the behavior is imparted by a huge strategy. Now, what is promoted in most of our Hollywood movies. Now, any Hollywood movie you watch, it promotes unrestricted sexuality. Will you agree with me? Will you agree with me? The hero feels for somebody, whether that somebody is married or not married or whatever, he engages into sex. Okay. So the children who are watching it, what do they learn? Oh, you get attracted to somebody, have that person, physical enjoyment. Yeah, that is heroism. Come on. Is that heroism actually? Oh, is that actually heroism? I don't think so. And who is a hero? Now, hero that is depicted is somebody who hit anybody who come against that person. That is, in reality, it is not like that. Like yesterday, in almost all the news medias in India, this was the news. There is a superstar called Vijay in Tamil Nadu. And he is such a superstar that in the movie, whatever he says, people take, because he is the superstar. But he approached the court to escape from the tax imposed upon his Rolls Royce car. So the judge rebuked him like anything and imposed 1 lakh rupee fine for approaching the court for the sake of relaxing the tax. And also said the statement, be a hero in your real life, not only in your mini screen or cine screen. But then children do not have that type of maturity, we understand. So actually 24/7, there is something that is guiding our children. 24/7, there is a higher level of strategy of the devil that is working, which really spoils the mind of the children. I hope you agree with me. Now, our opportunity, every family, okay, parents who sit here, please listen to me carefully. From morning till evening, through internet, through media, while talking to friends and while chatting and getting into social media, etc., 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 the devil has been so actively throwing the seeds of poison to the minds of children. Now, you got an opportunity in the evening when you all sit together for family prayer. I hope all of you sit for family prayer. Yeah, at least there are some families who think, prayer, that is to be done personally. Yeah, because we are so busy, we don't find time that everybody can sit to. Okay. But don't you think it is imperative that you find time to spend together? And how does our family prayer go on? Yeah, like in some family prayers, all the members of the family are so active, but they all come and sit for family prayer. The moment they sit, they all start yawning. Like that. Come on, up to this time, you were so active. The moment you sat for prayer, why this? Because this is the time you relax. Because this is the time you lean on to something. Some people, while sitting for family prayer, are sitting as if they want to sleep like that. And then take one small song. No time for two songs, because I need to give time for social media right after this. So just one song or one reading, this and that, and then the mother starts praying or the father starts praying, and the prayer goes for, in some families, okay, prayer goes for 20 minutes minimum. Children knows that. So by the time the father or mother started the prayer, children understand the rest of the 20 minutes, the train will go this side and that side, and by the time it comes back, it will be 20 minutes. I have sufficient time to have a nap. By the time the father finished prayer, the children are snoring and you take them to the bed. Is that family prayer? I don't think so. Okay, you pray not only 20 minutes, you pray 1.5 hours personally. Okay, do that. But when you sit for a family prayer, make your prayer short and sweet so that your children also can be impacted with your prayer. They can give attention to prayer. And ask them to pray. When they pray, teach them how to pray, and also when they read the scripture, interpret the scripture to them. Amen. If you, being the head of the family, if you are able to impart a spiritual sense to the children after they read that scripture, you are taking away that seeds of poison the devil has thrown into the hearts of your children. This is the time you nullify those evil inside the children. Do we do that? Please. Yeah, that is what I'm saying. Now, secular education, it doesn't have a scope of the spiritual needs of the children, because they know nothing about it. They are not bothered about spirituality and things like that. So that's where we need all this under school, VBS, family prayer, all the spiritual resources. I'll just give you this statistics, I mean this data. 121 times the word child is used in the Bible. 448 times children are used in the Bible. The word son or sons comes 2,700 times. Firstborn comes 100 plus times. Boys and girls comes 196 times. Altogether, child and family related words occur more than 8,000 times in the Bible. So you tell me whether children are important according to Bible or not. Now, for us, children are not very important, of course. In many, many communities I have seen, and I have observed in some churches, they are willing to spend lakhs of rupees for conducting convention and all kinds of public programs. But they are reluctant to spend any money for conducting a program for children. And I observed a strange fact. So there are so many types of ministries in the church. Somebody who exercised the ministry of prophecy, oh my goodness, what a great value is given to that person. But you ask somebody, what is the ministry you are doing? Yeah, I'm doing ministry among children. Ministry among children, so you didn't find any good ministry so far? What? So you think ministry among children is not a good ministry? Yeah, because you do ministry among children. Who is going to take care of your expenses? You become a prophet. People will call you for meeting and you'll be given huge rewards. You'll be a musician minister, a minister of music. You'll be so famous and you can earn a lot. But ministry among children, who is going to call you? Where is the ministry among children? Now, come on. I tell you this. Children are not an afterthought in the Bible. Yeah. Let me take you through some of the serious aspects, okay? Why should we talk about ministry to children today? Parenting itself is a ministry to children, because the Bible says children are a gift, a reward, okay? When you understand the ratio, let me tell you the ratio in Kerala. In Kerala, see, while I'm teaching, please ask me some questions so that we can have some interaction as we go ahead. I mean, please type some questions also, okay? Because otherwise, it will be simply a monotonous talk. So in between, if you can just type some questions, please, yeah. See, in Kerala, the ratio, the study says, you can see as you travel in Kerala, most of the places, I'm just saying because I'm more familiar with this context. Okay. Most of the junctions, you see big hoardings. It says, your dream for a baby never ends. Your dream for a baby fulfills here. And the picture of baby legs. Now, infertility treatment center, that is advertisement for that. Most of the major hospitals have got infertility treatment center. Why? Now hear me properly. Give me attention now. 20% of the couples in Kerala do not have children. Heard about that? If you take 100 families, out of that 20 families do not have children. Oh, alarming, right? It's a huge business these days, infertility treatment. Hundreds and thousands of couples. There are hospitals exclusively for infertility treatment. I've seen in Trivandrum, I've seen in Adur, I've seen even in Cochin, some of the major hospitals, they all have one floor exclusively for infertility treatment center. Why? Many reasons are there. Many, many reasons. Lifestyle and food habits and chemicals and medicines and maybe, I don't know, lot of reasons. But then, people who are sitting here, you are either a parent or you are somebody who ministered to children. In both these cases, I would like to tell you, if you're a parent and you have children, it is a reward. Children are given, okay? It's not on your merit. It's like when somebody gives you something, it's by grace. So you have a huge responsibility to fulfill towards God. That's my point here. Now, the first thing that I would like you to understand is, children thirst for care and attention. Now, look at this video. Hope you can hear the sound also. Oh, beautiful, beautiful. Now you tell me, what did most of the children expect? Majority of the children, what did they expect?
Hug.
A hug, yeah, right. I'm also a pastor. We have a church here at Kottayam. It's an independent Pentecostal church. And I think it was 3 years ago, I made a decision. The decision is, right after the worship service is over, right after I say the benediction, I get into the people. I mean, I just get out and then mingle with people in the church. But then I ensure that if I see a little baby, little child, I will hug that child and say, how are you? Good boy. How are you? Good girl. Now, what do I lose? I don't lose anything. A hug and a word of appreciation. Just saying, good girl, good boy. You know what? Within three months, it became a situation such a way that the moment I say benediction, I can see 10 to 15 children in front of me. They run towards the stage and they wait there. For what? So that I'll just come out and hug them and say goodbye. Only after giving all of them a hug, I can get into people. Now, one of the things that we are unable to do is, now, Corona made us into a totally strange situation. But I hope very soon we will be able to have this intimacy again. And now it became in such a way that now right after the Zoom meeting is over, okay? Right after the Zoom meeting is over, the first thing that I can hear is after I say benediction in Zoom, I can see from here and there people unmute and the little children say, Pastor Angel, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, Pastor Pa. Praise the Lord, Pastor Angel. You know why? They seek love and care. They seek love and care. Now, I'll tell you this. The question of why children behave like this, right? Okay. Now, look at this picture. Here is a little baby. Oh, the baby is very, very happy, smiling, wondering what is going on. What is there on the face? Yeah, I think it is, child is wondering what is happening. Okay. But then later, after some time. Oh, what is this all about? How do you explain this? What is this feeling? If there are Sunday school teachers who can help me.
Angry.
Angry, yeah, okay. Oh, what about this? What is these two doing? What is this attitude?
Sad.
Sad?
Adamant.
Adamant. Yeah, adamant, defensive. Yeah. But what about this, my goodness? Screaming, oh, stop you. Oh, like that. What is this? Oh, it's kind of extreme expression of anger. Okay. But she was not like that. She was happy. She was just wondering, what is this world all about? So what happened in between here? There is a huge gap of, let's say, 7 years, let's say 12 years, let's say 10 years. Now, what happened here? One of the things I would like you to consider, when a little baby is born, when a small child is born, talk about the behavior of the child. I think it is just like an empty slate, a slate in which nothing is written. That is an empty slate, right? Or an empty, clean whiteboard. Nothing is written. Who writes there first? After the baby is born, baby's behavior is just like a clean slate. Nothing is written. Who is the first one to write anything there? Can somebody unmute and tell me?
Parents.
Exactly. Among parents, the first one is?
Mother.
Mother, exactly. Exactly. See, if there is a little baby who is about to learn to walk and all is there, and you all are there, and the mother is also sitting somewhere, and I am there, a stranger, and what I do is, I stretch out my hands and say, baby, come here, come on. Will the baby come to me? I don't think so. You know what the baby will do? The first thing the baby do is to turn to her mother. You don't need to tell a word. From the mother's facial expression, the baby can understand whether I have a freedom to go or not. So now, it is the mother who first writes there. Some mothers write very positive things. You are good. You are excellent. Like Thomas Alva Edison, you know him, right? You've heard of him. Edison, there is a story, I don't know whether you have heard about it. Edison, the famous scientist, when he was at school, he was suffering with a learning disorder called dyslexia. Thomas Alva Edison, while he was in the school, he had dyslexia, a learning disability. So one day the school authorities called his mother and gave a letter. The letter, it says, your child has got a learning disability, so we are unable to have your child in the class anymore. So please find out a better solution to this. Probably I mean, those days special schools were not available. So find out some option, that's all. So we are unable to have him in the school anymore. And the mother took the baby and went home. If you were in the place of that mother, what would have been your response? Some mothers will cry at that moment itself and say, "Oh God, why did you give me a baby like this? Oh God, what sin have I committed to deserve this?" On the way home, you don't talk anything to the baby, and the baby identifies there is something huge, a crisis going on concerning me. I am the troublemaker here. And the baby asks the mother, "So mommy, what is it all about?" And the mommy says, "My child, we can't do anything. Sometimes we are helpless before God. Monet, God has created you as a mentally retarded boy." Actually, it is not mental retardation. Learning disability is totally different, of course. But many mothers give the maximum emotional thing into it, you know. "So, my boy, you cannot have education anymore. Please don't mind, okay? What to do? This is our life." And the baby writes here something, okay, in the whiteboard. "I am not capable." Oh, the first lesson in life. My goodness. Second lesson. "Nobody will accept me. God is so cruel to me. I am created so weird. And there is a life growing up. What is happening in that life? All through the childhood, blaming, criticizing, self-harassment, and suicidal tendency, and child becomes a nuisance to the society. But Thomas Alva Edison's mother was different. That's why I'm talking to parents now. You know what she did? She said, "Thank you. Thank you. This is a huge compliment. Thank you." School authorities were wondering, what is she saying? And the child felt there is something good. In the letter, something is good about me. Okay. Child was very happy. And she took him home. And next day, the mother said, "Edison, you know what? You're not going to school anymore." And Edison said, "What? Why am I not going to school?" "Yeah, you are such a brilliant intellectual boy that you cannot be accommodated with those medium type of people because you are too brilliant." Edison said, "Oh, is it so? So Edison, I am going to be your school. I'm going to have the school here, right here in this room. Are you happy about it?" And Edison jumped up and down and said, "Yeah, I'm so happy about it. My mother is going to be the teacher. My house is going to be the school." Exactly. And you read in the internet, his mother became his school. And he became a very famous scientist. So now look at here, this gap, okay? Now, if you fill up this gap with this one, criticism. Criticism, criticism, criticism. Whether the child do this, criticism. Don't do this, again, criticism. Now, I'm talking about a mother or father who thinks that they should make the child better. Intention is good. I'm not blaming parents. Intention is good. But the thing is, like I was talking to a young person recently, and she is finding it very difficult to sustain her family life. After marriage, it is now almost 2 years. And she finds that she is unable to get along and a lot of quarrel every day. So the husband and wife came here. And while we were talking, one of the things I identified is that she is expecting extreme care, not normal care, extreme care from her husband. And the husband says, "Sir, please tell her to treat me as a normal husband. I cannot become a dad to her. Sometimes I feel she is expecting that I become a dad to her." I was just talking and she revealed to me, Sir, I never had a good dad in my life. I missed a good dad. Why did you say that? Yeah, and she said so many things. One of the things she said was, sir, maybe I was studying in second standard or third standard, I don't remember, but I still remember this very well. I got 99 out of 100. And I came home so happy. And I showed my parents my result. 99 out of 100. You know, first thing my dad did, a big slap on me. I got shocked. Why did you slap me? Where is that one mark? What? Where is that one mark? Where did you lose it? You played around. You were not serious in your studies. And you lost that one mark, right? Sir, now let me put it this way. I was devastated. That is what she said. I mean, it started from there. Every now and then, harassment, criticism, criticism, criticism. So when I got married, I thought I'm going to have a husband who is going to fulfill that bridge, the bridge, that gap, you know, which I lost. But what to do? He is also behaving like my dad. So that which is triggering within me is my anger to my dad, actually. But I'm taking it on my husband. I'm so sorry. I understand it is happening. But now again, from where did you get it? From a deviant childhood. So you give criticism to your children all the time. What happens? Child learns to condemn. She became like this. From here, criticism is given, and the condemnation and seeking negative everything and everywhere, and every words negative, negative, negative. Even if somebody seeks something positive, the child is interpreting as negative. Why? That is what the child is fed with. Oh, you feed the child with jealousy. All the time, jealousy and disapproval and things like that. The child learns to feel guilt all the time. The child never trusts anybody. The child is taught not to trust. Yeah, some parents do this. They don't do it knowingly, but look at this. From the time the child is born and are growing up, like there is a funny story about Jewish people. Again, I'm not mentioning something negative, but it's a funny story. Take it for fun, okay? So Jewish people are known to be very successful in business. So maybe those who don't like that, create this funny story maybe. The story says about a dad who teaches the lesson of business to the child, okay? Now the dad takes the child to the wall and makes the child stand on the top of the wall. And the child stands down, and the father stands down, stretching out the hand, says, "Baby, jump!" And the baby jumps. But the father doesn't catch the baby. The father turns and walks away. The baby falls down and starts crying. Now the father comes back and says, first lesson in business, don't even trust your dad. Okay, you can expect how this baby will develop an attitude. I'm just saying. So you feed jealousy to children, and the children turn out to be feeling guilt and distress and things like that. So you give fear, what happens? The child becomes so apprehensive. Child develop a very, very low self-esteem. Yesterday, I was talking to this father, trying to help him understand how the whole relationship between him and his daughter damaged the self-esteem of the child. Do you want to hear that? A 25-year-old girl sitting in a counseling center and saying that, sir, I never look at mirror. What? Why you don't look at mirror at all? Then how do you comb your hair? Yeah, I have some understanding, so I do this and that, that's all. I don't look at my mirror. Why you don't look at mirror? I don't like myself. But she is beautiful, okay? I don't look at mirror. Why? I don't like myself. Oh. The self-esteem is, if there is negative points, she gets that. Now, she is brought in for counseling because she says she is not ready for a marriage. And the parents start her proposals and she started rejecting, and there is huge level of fear, premarital fear. I had to deal with that to equip her for a marriage. So when I was exploring, this is what I understood. Her dad used to be so strict. And yesterday in the evening, I was talking to this dad for a session. And he said, yes, you are right. I was like that and like this. But I did it not with a negative purpose. I did it so that my child will be the best child. But now I realize it all fired back. Now I had to facilitate some healing between this father and daughter. But then, on the other hand, now this is one side, the other side of it. You give appreciation to the child every time. The child learns to like himself or herself. You give approval to the baby many times. The child learns to like himself or herself and also appreciate others. And the child thinks it's a good world to live with. Now, here is an opportunity. Okay, parents, here is your opportunity. Take, for example, what happened to Samuel. Okay, now, if you are somebody sitting here worried about the behavior of your child, okay, somewhere down the line, you felt your child has not been able to develop a healthy personality or behavior or spirituality, attitude, etc. Consider this. Case study one, Samuel. All what he had to see in the temple was Hophni and Phinehas. How were they? Oh, Hophni and Phinehas. They never bothered about spirituality. Poor people will come to give offer sacrifice, and these guys goes with that iron kind of equipment and take the meat. And they say, would you please wait? Let me finish the sacrifice. After that, I'll give you wholeheartedly. Well, push them away and then they take away this. That is the respect to God. Not only that, complete immorality with ladies. And as Samuel, the boy, was growing up, this is the model he has seen, right? Do you find the Samuel anytime going with that iron kind of a thing to pick up some meat? You don't find. Why? Did you find Samuel as he was a teenager going after Hophni and Phinehas to sexual immorality? No, never. Samuel wanted to listen to God. Samuel wanted to all the time be drawn close to God. Why? Let me put it this way. Okay? Mothers, listen to me now very, very carefully. You know what? God decided that a Samuel must grow up as a very holy person, a prophet of God, a priest of God, somebody who will become a judge for people, all these together fulfilled in one person. He should be the gem out of his behavior, right? Now, you know from where God did his work? Started from Hannah. You know, it started from making Hannah barren. Because God knew when Hannah is encountering a great difficult time in life, she'll be growing in her spirituality. She will become humble. When she encounters with the difficulty and issue in life, she will become spiritual more and more. God knew that. Now, let me give my imagination here. One day, she went to the temple of God and said, Lord, see, this Penina is disturbing me like anything. So I find it so hard to survive. So in order to withstand before Penina, I need a child, please. And the Lord said, no, no. After some time, she went and made another request. Lord, you see, my husband, the love of my husband is decreasing. So I think if it goes like this, I will not be able to get the love of my husband, and it will be a huge difficulty for me. So, Lord, please, in order to get back the love of my husband, would you please give me a boy? The Lord said, no, not yet. Time has not yet come. Still, she began to grow and grow and grow, and it reached the climax. And one day she went to the Lord and said, Lord, in order to withstand before Penina, that child, I don't want, okay? In order to get back the love of my husband, that child I don't want. But I want a child so that I can grow up that child for you. Oh, there was the answer. And the Lord said, exactly, got you. This is what I have been waiting for. This is what I have been waiting for. And the answer is given then and there. And now consider this. I can imagine every day in that empty, clean whiteboard called mind, she started writing. What did she write? One day she wrote there, you are special gift of God. Wow. And the Lord was so happy from above. Another day she wrote there, you are supposed to live a holy and separate life for God in the temple. And the Lord was so happy looking at that. And one day she said, you are a dedicated child for God so that God can use you to bring people back to God. And the Lord said, yes, that is what I hope. That is what I expect. Okay, my dear people of God who listen to me today, parents, what do you write? When was the last time you imparted a vision for God to your child? When was the last time you said to your child, my baby, above all, my desire is that you will do something for God in the days to come. Now, when I say this, I'm just not simply saying a dogmatic thing. We have only two boys, and myself and my wife. Every day when we pray before them, helping them to listen to our words. We pray that, Lord, please make both of these boys to be your ministers in the days to come. We are trying to impart a vision to them. In a way, trying to impart to them our earning desire that they both must become pastors, servants of God. Trying to create a vision in them. When was the last time you did that? Okay, I mean, please don't misunderstand me. You will say, Pastor Vani is not for everybody. Yeah, in this modern world, who want to become a minister? Come on, please, don't devalue our children. Now, I say it because a day is coming, okay? Whether you believe it or not, okay? Due to this corona and the famine that is coming and all those what is happening in the world and what is happening in Jerusalem and what is happening in terms of worldwide acceptance of biometric identification system and everything. I strongly believe the time has come to an end. I 100% I believe in our generation itself we will hear the trumpet of God. I strongly believe in our generation itself we will listen to the trumpet of God. The moment that happens, or the moment we die, all what matters is what we have done for Jesus. Is there any logic in what I'm saying? At what age you die? Now, I better ask this to children. I usually do this when I talk to children. Some say at the age of 70, some say 90, 80. Okay, good. But a boy went to his mother and asked this funny question. Mommy, at what age people die? And the mother said, okay, boy, maybe I'll teach you in an interesting way. Get ready. Let's go for a walk. They both went for a walk. She took him to a cemetery and said, you read the tombstones. At what age these people died? And he went on reading 80, 17, 25, 40, 92, 8. Oh, okay. At the end of that journey, as they came out of the cemetery, she asked him this question. Now you tell me, at what age people die? His reply, Mommy, we don't know. We don't know. You don't know. I also don't know. At what age we die. Now, you may have a huge deposit as a bank balance. You may have the best facility anybody can dream for. But the moment you stand before the judgment throne of God, what matters is, what have you done for Jesus, right? That is where I connect it as a ministry to children. Yeah, please go ahead and type your questions now. We will set apart another 20 minutes for questions. So I would like you to type your questions in the chat box so that we can try to handle some of them. Yeah, okay. So by the time you type your questions, I can also share with you a video and give you time to type your question. Okay. Yeah, all right. So here we go.
Great. Sorry. Hey, Papa. Papa, why are you here?
நீ பேட் டச் பண்ண.
நான் உனக்கு ஆட்டோ தான பாப்பா ஓட்ட சொல்லி கொடுக்கறேன். நீ வா நான் சொல்லி கொடுக்கறேன். நீ வா.
இல்ல வர மாட்டேன்.
வா பாப்பா நான் என்ன பண்ணப் போறேன்னா வா.
இல்ல.
ஏய் நீ நடந்தது யார்கிட்டயுமே நீ சொல்ல கூடாது. சரியா? அப்படி நீ சொல்றதா இருந்தா நீ ஸ்கூல்ல வாழ்த்தன பண்ற எல்லாத்தையும் உங்க அப்பா கிட்ட சொல்லி கொடு.
சொல்லிக்கோ. நீ இப்ப ஒழுங்க ஆட்டோ ஏடு. இல்லனா நான் கத்திடுவேன்.
நான் சும்மா சொன்ன பாப்பா. நீ நம்பிட்டியா? மாமா உன்கிட்ட விளையாண்டேன். சரியா? ஏறு வா.
வா பெட்டு.
அம்மா, இந்த அங்கிள் என்ன பேட் டச் பண்ணி டார்ச்சர் பண்ணாருமா.
அப்படியா? எங்க டச் பண்ணாரு?
இங்க.
டேய்
இல்லக்கா.
ராஸ்கல், குழந்தை மேல கை வைக்கிறியா? இரு உன்ன. டேய் நில்றா. என்ன நம்பி அம்சம் பாரு.
குட் கேர்ள். இப்படிதான் அம்மா கிட்ட எல்லாத்தையும் சொல்லணும். சரியா? நைட் அப்பா வந்தோடனே போலீஸ் கம்ப்ளைண்ட் கொடுத்துடலாம். வா. ஒருக்கி
ஏமா நின்னு பாக்குற, மடியில உட்கார்ந்து பாரு. வா.
முடியாது. அம்மா சொல்லிருக்காங்க, அம்மா அப்பா தவிர யார் மடியிலயும் உட்கார கூடாதுன்னு.
நான் உன் மாமா தானம்மா, ஏன் மடியில உட்காரலாமே?
இருங்க, நான் அம்மா கிட்ட கேக்குறேன்.
பாப்பா, அம்மாட்ட எல்லாம் கேட்க வேணா. நீ கேம்ஸ் ஆடு. நீ கேம்ஸ் ஆடு.
நீங்க எதுக்கு டோர் க்ளோஸ் பண்ணீங்க?
நம்ம ஒரு விளையாட்டு
விளையாடுவோமா? டோர் க்ளோஸ் பண்ணிட்டு அப்படி என்ன விளையாடணும்?
பேய் விளையாட்டு. இருட்டாத தானே பயங்கரமா இருக்கும், ஜாலியா இருக்கும். என்ன?
அந்த அம்மா சொல்லிருக்காங்க, டோர் க்ளோஸ் பண்ணிட்டு யார் கூடயும் விளையாட கூடாதுன்னு.
அண்ண கூட தான் விளையாடுற, ஒன்னாவது பாப்பா.
இல்ல, நீங்க இப்ப டோர் ஓபன் பண்ணுங்க, ஏன்னா நான் கத்திடுவேன்.
இல்ல இல்ல, ஒண்ணு இல்ல, அண்ணா திறந்து விட்டுறேன். சரியா?
Yeah, in India, every 2.5 hours, a child younger than 60 years is raped. After every 13 hours, a child under 10, and one in every 10 children is sexually abused at any point of time. Studies propose that over 7,200 children, including infants, are raped every year, of which many cases go unreported. In India, every other child is exposed to some form of sexual misconduct, and one in five faces severe sexual abuse. Overall, nearly 42% of Indian girls have gone through the trauma of sexual violence before they reach the age of 20. What is the result? Fear. I have seen many children in my counseling center who see fearful dreams constantly. A giant is coming and raping them. They are unable to get concentration in their studies. Why? There is a huge fear. You inquire about it and from where this fear came, and you understand the sexual abuse that happened. Anger. The other day I was teaching in a teenager's class, and then this lockdown times many times. And the most recent thing is, I told them, you type me direct question. I'm not going to reveal your name. All what I want is a question. And let us discuss what can we do to overcome that. And one person typed this question to me. Uncle, if we take revenge upon someone who sexually abused us, will God forgive? Because they have done to us that we are taking revenge. And in many Zoom meetings these days, I hear questions like this. That some children say they engaged into this Insta connection, and ultimately they said, I'm coming to meet you. Tell me a time when your parents are not there at home. And I say, no, I will not. And then they threaten me, and I don't know what to do. And on and on. Severe anger. And many children who sit in my counseling center told me, right after I underwent this kind of an experience of abuse, all what I did was to search in internet for how to kill somebody without any evidence remaining. I wanted to kill that person. Many times in my dream, I have tried that. But every time I try, I'm not able to. There is so much of guilt. I was talking to somebody who undergoes sexual abuse, and I told this person, so which means because you undergo this kind of an experience from your neighbor, you feel so much of anger towards him. And she said, no, sir, it's not anger. And I said, then what is the feeling that you have? It is guilt. Oh, why do you feel guilty? Do you think you also had a role in that whole sin? Yes, sir. I was supposed to say no in the beginning, which I didn't do. Somewhere I felt maybe my curiosity led me into not resisting him from doing that. And now I realize that I've committed the biggest mistake in my life. God even will not forgive me. Guilt, severe guilt. Hatred. They hate male world at all. One person who completed MBBS, when this marriage proposals came in and she was there like the engagement itself has happened, and then they started talking to each other, and this boy is in a different country, but then all the decisions were made and now he is supposed to come and then the marriage to take place. And while they were talking, this boy talked some sexuality because she is going to be his wife. So after some conversation, the sexual topic came up and immediately she cut the phone. So he tried to contact her again and she doesn't pick up the phone. So he contacted his parents contacted her parents, and her parents questioned her, and she said, he talked with me sexually. They said, okay, that's okay, because you're going to get married in a month or two. So what is wrong in that? No. The moment somebody talks sexuality, I get fearful. Oh, No, talking about sexuality, why it is making you extremely... No, no, please, please, I'm not ready for a marriage, please. I don't want to get married with him or anybody else. Then they brought her for counseling. And this is what we found out. When she had to undergo this abuse experience at the age of 8, remember 8. When she had to undergo this experience at the age of 8, it was such a terrible experience, fear-evoking experience, such a traumatic experience that she thought this is sexuality all about. Now, there was a huge requirement for a counseling where she had to explore that, ventilate her feeling and overcome that, come out of it and prepare herself for a marriage. Marriage preparation becomes a huge task these days for young people. Why? Because of these issues. Because of these issues. Now, don't you think you have a huge task when you observe among your children some of those things that they show as symptoms? Okay. Now, when we talk about, some children, when you see that they demonstrate some different attitude, like, for example, every now and then, the child is persistently sad. Persistently sad. Yeah, it would be some challenge. Maybe that the child is undergoing, yeah, okay. One person type the question. Others, please go and type your questions. Please. So when you find your child is persistently sad, it's a warning signal. It's like the red light. Beep, beep, beep. Give me time. I'm in trouble. Or your child is persistently seeing dreams that is so fearful. Or the child started saying, why should I exist at all? I should end my life. Or the child stopped all the socialization. Like the child used to be so interactive, but all of a sudden the child stopped everything. And the child preferred to sit at home, not mingling with anybody else, not interested to eat or overeating, not sleeping at all or oversleeping. All these are symptoms, signs. Now, it gives us message that we need to set apart considerable time talking to them. Okay, here is one question. You can type to me personally. I mean, if there is a personal question, you can type to me personally, direct message so that others don't know who is typing a question. Okay, thank you. Pastor, what would your opinion about the classes through online for kids because to the transition due to COVID? Yeah, I mean, of course, we don't like online classes. Nobody, especially for children, I don't know how many of them likes online classes because the teachers have no clue what they are doing. Even the video is on. You feel like the child is attending the class, but the child is somewhere else. Online class has its own disadvantages also. One of the huge disadvantages many parents say is these days because device and internet is available to all the children, we have no clue to assess where they are going in this huge world of internet. So it has got its own limitations, but then if you can make your class very interactive up to an extent, you can ensure effectiveness. Next one. Can you suggest a way to educate and guide our kids regarding the sexual abuse? I mean, a way that the kids could understand. Yeah. I think as parents, the best thing I would advocate is you develop a relationship with your children which is very open and intimate. Means, if there is any trap your child is probably tempted to, child has the freedom to tell you. And the child knows that you are someone who will give time to listen rather than getting angry the moment you hear this and that. That open communication is very, very important in helping the children who undergo abuse. Secondly, by the time the child is reaching to 7 years, 5 years, 8 years. Don't wait until they are 16 and 17. At those tender age itself, you must tell your children what is a right touch and what is a wrong touch. What are the things they must be careful in dealing with adults, including their first cousins? Including their first uncles, their intimate family relatives also. Because in many cases I have come across in counseling, the one abused them first was their immediate relative, including cousins and uncles. You never expect that. Yeah. So you must be very, very meticulous in helping your children to understand what is right touch and what is wrong touch. And the moment there is a wrong touch, they should have freedom to come to you and tell you. The moment you hear that, don't punish your child. Don't blame your child. Instead, sit with the child and you together, chalk out a strategy and plan to handle it effectively. And one more thing. Many children, when they undergo abuse, they feel so guilt about themselves. Many times they feel that it is because of their problem. But assure them that you are a child and innocent. Don't approve the feeling of guilt. Instead, accept their desire to change and appreciate that. And then equip them so that they can resist next time. Can I educate my daughter as a dad, or should I ask her mom to do so? My daughter is more attached to me. See, if you have a right communication between children and parents, whether it is you are a dad or a mother, it doesn't matter. Because your child is able to understand you as the parent, I think it doesn't make much difference. I mean, again, we have our own ways of dealing with and explaining things, like, or you can search in YouTube and find out a very good educative video and download it and help your child to go through that. Or you can even get together, like father and mother sitting together and telling the children certain instructions. Or I think in most of the cases, it is the mother who tells the children, whether the boys or girls, whoever. And it again depends on the communication that is maintained at home. Yeah, that is what I would say. After COVID, most of the churches are running in online platform. How effective it would be for kids for the spiritual things? Yeah. See, one of the concerns everybody, including myself, as I am also a pastor of a church, had this, like, online worship. I mean, you don't even see children. And children, they sit somewhere and there is one mobile phone somewhere there. And even while they sit in the church physically, their attention span is so small and they don't get many of the things that we preach, of course. But what about in Zoom? So the effect is so small. So it is at that context that many churches started Zoom Kids Church. Like, before you start the worship or after the worship is over, there is 1 hour of Kids Church in which you show their programs. They are given opportunity to do some program and small classes given, a small story by somebody. And it is a great time that members of the church can get a great opportunity to minister to children. You can assign all these. I mean, our team here, Excel team, is committed to help you in that. So please don't hesitate to contact us. We can train you for that, to effectively conduct a kids church, because we are doing it in many places. So one of the things that we should consider is this issue. So, yeah. Now, in this class today, we have gone through many of the important things that we should be aware about. And as parents, again, let me emphasize this. Impart to them the word of God. Maintain a right communication. foster spirituality with all the means and methods you can. And now, as we foresee this program for children in the days to come, make all the effort that you will make it a grand success in terms of spiritual impact upon children and especially teenagers, because we witness a huge impact of the world in creating a lot of darkness in the minds of people in this new generation, Gen Z. And therefore, let us give ourselves to the hands of God so that the Lord will equip each one of us to be ministers to children, to achieve that ultimate purpose of training them into godliness, which is the most significant lesson for today. And thank you. Thank you so much for your kind attention. God bless each one of you. And thank you very much.